Hi, this is Bobby Brown, and welcome to another fucking podcast.
You kids with your loud music and your Dan Fogelberg, your Zima, hula hoops, and Pac-Man video games, don't you see? People today have attention spans that can only be measured in nanoseconds.
See, son, old legends never die. They just lose weight.
Like a legend and an out-of-work bum with a lot of lightning.
Crazy
dead fucker! Party time!
Yes, it is party time. Hello, Hollywood. Hello, world. And hello, my loyal minions. It is good to see you, and it's always good to be seen. I am Izzy Presley, and this is Metal Edge Magazine's another fucking podcast. Got a great show for you guys today. We have a double feature, ladies and gentlemen, and we're going to get to our first band. We got Junkyard, Patrick and Todd here from Junkyard in just 1 second. Make sure you guys hit up all the social media at Real Izzy Presley all the way across the board, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And of course, the show pages, another effing podcast on Facebook. And yes, if you just search Metal Edge Magazine's another effing podcast, you will find it. Then go like Metal Edge Magazine on Facebook as well and on the Instagram, and follow Paul Gargano on the Instagram as well, not on Twitter, because he never touches his Twitter. Ladies and gentlemen, he's our white knight, booby, Paul Gargano.
Three people know what you're talking about. Three people.
That's okay. That's okay.
All right. That's okay.
That's what I do.
You know what? Here's the deal. I work for a living, so I don't have time. So I don't have time to put pictures of me everywhere around Los Angeles all day. Every time I do log, I might log into Twitter more or Instagram more if every time I logged in it wasn't like eight pictures of you at the Karate Kid house.
Or him tripping and falling somewhere.
Or tripping and falling. Oh, yeah.
I still wish there was video of that. Oh.
I'm sure there is.
There's not. I asked. I totally asked. Oh, I just got a text message from Mr. Ace Von Johnson. He says, Paul, define quote work, unquote.
Oh boy.
This could be a long one.
Oh, and just really quick, if you are in the greater Los Angeles area, you can join me and the Smoke and Kills for our world album release party tomorrow night at the Mint. Come on down. We go on at 9 o'clock. Show starts at 8:15. And I just invited the great Patrick Mazingo and Todd Muscat down to join us as well from Junkyard. Welcome back. We had you guys on a long time ago.
Was it 2015?
Yeah. Cause it was, we world premiered,
Faded
on this show. And that was really surreal for me. Cause you guys reached out to me.
Yes. Yeah.
And I got a little blubbery.
I got a little beclamped. I got a little beclamped.
How the hell are you guys doing? I mean, we're going to world premiere Lifer at the end of the interview. But so you guys have had a lot going on. You're out playing.
Well, since 2015. Yeah. We've kind of, you know, we've had a few things happen here and there. We had an album and we did some shows and stuff like that. But no, in seriousness, this single, honestly, we've been sitting on this thing for probably going back to early 2019, this song. And like what's that, Todd?
16 months, 17 months or something that we figured
from the point where we recorded it. Yeah. Yeah. So basically, long story short, we had this song, we did it on the Summertime Blues 2019 tour. And when we got back from that, we decided, okay, in February of 2020, we're going to record this right after we do the Danko run. And we did four shows with your next guest, Danko Jones. Fucking, oh my God. Just, you know, a dream come true. It was only four shows, but for us, it was a dream come true. But so once we got off that run, you know, we had a summer tour planned with my old band Speed Buggy that we're doing two shows with this weekend. But we hopped in the studio and we were like, okay, we're going to knock this out. We're going to knock out a video. It's going to be done by June. And then
Best laid plans, right?
Yeah, exactly. And it was like, you know, we were trying to like figure out like, oh, well, we can still put it out. And our label's like, no, we can't, because all the printing places, everybody's shut down.
But all we had to do was flatten the curve. We just needed to shut down for 2 weeks and flatten the curve. And then we'd
exactly. And then the single would have been flattened and produced and fucking shoved out there like a Frisbee. It would have been great. But instead, there was this virus thing that, you know, whatever. And but we finally, you know, as we all had to do, we got our shit together. And once we got vaccinated, we went back in and we actually did the B-side in October of last year. And at that point, we're like, okay, great. You know, hopefully, like by summer of 2021, we'll have this out. But, you know, as things happened and things got kind of fast tracked on the vaccine for us in February, March, April, we got vaccinated. We got able to do the video, and then things started opening up again. And that's when the printing plants started going into full effect. And now we're finally at the release date for Friday, where we finally get this thing out to the world. But, you know, in a few minutes, people are going to be able to hear it for the first time ever. Actually, I haven't heard it since we mixed it, so it'll be my first time hearing it as well.
So I've listened to it 3 times today. I've heard it more than you have.
You have, yes.
Wow.
And you've heard it more times than I actually played it, because I think I did 2 takes and that was it.
You know, the one thing I got from it, it's a really heavy AC/DC vibe.
It is. And it's something, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Todd. I mean, on the first and second record, those songs weren't really AC/DC-ish. You know, they're more Skinner meets Motorhead, and it had, you know, peaks and valleys of AC/DC. But with this one, I mean, this one, I don't know if Tim and Brian really, and especially David, really went at it and said, well, let's do something that's, you know, that's on par or, you know, equal to similar to AC/DC or whatever. It just kind of came out as it came out.
It comes out because they were, you know, AC/DC writes such good shit. So when you're writing something and you go, hey, this sounds great, a lot of times it sounds like AC/DC.
That's what I was just going to say. I think a lot of it is aging gracefully, becoming better at the craft. And as you get better at the craft, or as you get older and appreciate the craft more, you either get better at doing closer to AC/DC, or you just begin to appreciate AC/DC a lot more. That's what I find. As my hair gets grayer, I just appreciate AC/DC so much more. It's just like,
very true.
And you hear AC/DC in places you didn't hear it before, because they're just right. That point. Yeah.
They've influenced a ton of people, you know, and it's just, I don't know, if you lived at that time, you know, when Bond was still alive, when I was in high school, they were gods. And that was the soundtrack to my life, and I know a lot of my friends' lives. And so it just kind of seeps into you, you know, who you are, what you're about. I mean, how many people, when an AC/DC song comes on, just start rock every time, boom, go volume goes in my room. So it's one of those things, it's like, you can't deny what's coming out of you, and part of what's come into you is AC/DC, you know?
It's really in your DNA. I mean, from the point, me and Todd have been a rhythm section probably going back to 1984.
84.
Wow. And that was our first band was a punk rock kind of Dead Boys meets,
like a SoCal Dead Boys, like Adolescence, if you guys know. I mean, that was kind of, we've got compared to the Adolescence a lot. We had like a signature so-called guitar sound.
But
it was very, you know, there's some Black Flag into it a little bit, I think, but
there was always that AC/DC, like, it was always like, you know, that was the bar. Even though, you know, we discussed it, it was like, yeah, we'll get it to that point. It was always a reference point for us. Mm-hmm. And this was 1984 punk rock, you know, where people were like, well, fuck you, AC/DC. It's like, nah, in LA, AC/DC was not bad mouth or anything like that.
I was just thinking about that this morning. There were certain bands that all the punkers dug. Motorhead was one, AC/DC was one. It was Judas Priest. It was Cheap Trick was one of all bands. Now this pop, but, you know, there were certain bands that got a pass. Aerosmith is another band that I think a lot
Aerosmith,
you know, so you know, it wasn't like punk rock hated all that stuff. They just hated the bands that didn't come across as real. You know, I think they kind of like, okay, this band's not real. I mean, the Stones were real, but Stones were kind of, they're a little bit, you know, they're in a league of their own. But like a band like Aerosmith, you could tell that they were real. They're fucked up druggies. You know, punkers love Johnny Thunders, you know? So there's a lot of that.
Yeah.
No, absolutely. Oh, shit. I forgot this at the top of the show because I said I wasn't going to drink tonight. Because, I'm going to go over to Dawson's. We'll go through the record. And then I'm going to go work. But, you know,
Is Dawson's your barometer for not drinking?
No, these guys are my barometer for not drinking. And I saw Patrick say, hey, I got to start pre-gaming. So let's crack one for the working man.
Oh, boy.
Oh, yeah. Cheers.
Well, I'll water to you guys.
And in the words of the great Don Jameson, to hell with our livers.
Exactly. Yeah. At my age, what liver?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
right.
Petrified.
My liver terminated its lease a long time ago. It's like, I'm out of here.
Yeah, I'm out of here.
I'm done working.
It's like, fuck all y'all. I'm done.
It's safer on the streets.
How much do you think experience and longevity has affected your songwriting?
Oh, immensely. I mean, with this band, I mean, we haven't really went through a lot of lineup changes, and the lineup changes that we did go through, we'd never auditioned anybody. It was always like, well, we know him. And, you know, especially when it came to like replacing Brian, it was like, well, Brian wrote songs with us in 1991. So let's, you know, that's the most logical choice. And, what was the question? Jesus Christ, the booze is kicking in.
How much has longevity and experience affected songwriting?
Well, we're fucking still here. We're writing decent stuff. I mean, I think songwriting-wise, things really took a turn for the better once we got the deal with Acetate. We got approached by a major label or whatever. So that kind of got us off our ass. It's like, well, instead of playing the old songs, let's write some new ones. So we wrote a bunch of new ones, or Tim and Brian and David did, and Todd as well. And then once we hit the high water era of the band, which was like 2017, that's when we got Jimmy in the band. Everything kind of like went up. And as far as the longevity, it was the next logical progression for the band. And at that point, you know, High Water turned into the Rome is Burning era EP that we put out during the lockdown or whatever. And with this, with Lifer and Last of a Dying Breed, it's the next logical progression in songwriting for Tim. And during the pandemic, Tim was on fire writing brand new stuff. So we've got a whole slew of new stuff that we're going to be working on as soon as we, you know, milk this single for as much as we can, or promote. And then once we hop in, and David has alluded to this before, the next release that we do, I think we can all say, all five of us can really say, this is probably the best Junkyard stuff that people are going to be hearing. And we don't know when it's going to come out, probably this time next year or something, but the stuff that Tim and David and Brian, because Brian Bicker still contributes with us.
Yeah.
And the stuff that they were coming up with, you know, during the shutdown. Oh, my God. I mean, it's fantastic. And Todd came up with a couple of ideas that to me are probably the number one and number two singles for the new album. So it's just a matter of time. But yeah, longevity breeds, you know, it breeds, you know, you get smarter, you know, you don't waste a bunch of time on, you know, a bunch of, you know, bullshit fucking courses like rock and roll will set the night on fire or whatever. I don't know who did that, but I think it's some band with a bunch of makeup on.
That's exactly what I was going to say, Pat, is just you kind of learn, you know, what to throw away early in the process and just cut to the bone real quick, you know?
There was a great quote from Gene Simmons, God, fuck, when in 1990 he goes, look, we can't rewrite Strutter. Trust me, we've tried.
Yeah.
When you guys are writing it, are you looking back at the old stuff going, there might be some new ideas to come off of this, or is that just boom, that was that era and that's it?
That was that
never
era.
No, that was then, this is now. You know, it's like we can never rewrite Hollywood, we can never rewrite Simple Man, we can never rewrite All the Time in the World, we can never rewrite Slipping Away or all that.
We don't even try.
No, we don't try. I mean, the only time we ever look back at our old catalog is to figure out which songs we don't want to play live. That's really it. And it's like, okay, we do the hits, and then that song, it's like, nah, fuck it, whatever. You know, we'll throw a cover in that place. But go ahead, Tom.
No, I'm just saying, the closest we ever get to that kind of thing is just saying, hey, but I think we're short, like maybe a song that's a little bit more upbeat, you know, this kind of sound, you know, but we never try to go back and farm from stuff from the past.
Yeah.
Just like maybe a tempo thing, you know, let's get something that's got this little faster tempo.
Especially, I mean, lyrically, I mean, that was then, this is now. And especially like with Lifer, Last of a Dying Breed, the lyrics are very, you know, on point, on subject now. And especially when it comes to the new album, I mean, David's writing, you know, pandemic stuff that, you know, I think will end up, you know, being such a big truth 5 years from now. I mean, talking about how people like, you know, oh my God, I don't know how to deal with the pandemic. I'm by myself. It's like, well, David's like, well, fuck that shit. I'm by myself. And now you have to figure out how to go on my schedule kind of thing.
Yeah.
So we look back every once in a while. I think we look back every once in a while just to fill up the set list.
Gotcha. Paul, you had a question?
I think that's one of the big differences too with the bands that I think I said before, but do you age gracefully when you don't try to keep repeating the shit you did before? And that's right. Just the bands that are worth listening today aren't trying to redo the stuff they did in 1989 or 1992. They're going, yeah, what do we want to do today? Because, you know, we've all aged together, and you don't want to hear that same stuff over. If you do, turn on Hair Nation. But at the end of the day, you know, you can only listen to that for so long before you go, okay, I've heard the same 12 songs over and over again. So, you know, that's the difference.
The bands I find interesting are the ones that, like Pat was talking about, it's like you grow as you get older, and and your life changes, your circumstance changes. David's not going to sing about, you know, Hollywood from back in the day, because that was back in the day. And I think that he does a really good job at, like, it's very personal. Everything is, you know, is real. It's not, you know, let's not, he touches on things that affect him. And, you know, and within that, it affects the little guy, you know, the common street guy. All across the world, he's a work, you know, salt of the earth, and so I think it's really effective. And I David does a great job doing that.
He does, yeah.
There was, a movie quote: "Work for the working man." What's that from Tommy Boy?
Looking for the work of the
hell. Somebody help me here. Nobody. Okay.
I'm useless.
All right, something for the working man. Forget about it. Somebody watching will know, or it'll come back to me later. You know what I'm talking about, Izzy. I can see there's smoke coming out from
my head. There is. Yeah.
Roach knows the answer to that.
This is why you have to watch this on YouTube and not just listen on audio, because you can look at my ugly, awkward face, who still doesn't know how to look, where to look into the Zoom a year later.
Right,
and
right.
And also, does he literally have an aneurysm trying to figure out the quote from Tommy Clark?
also, really quick,
Google it, like,
Paul, since you say that, if you are watching on YouTube and you want to listen to the show live, just go to spreaker.com/user/Izzy Presley, hit that follow button, then you will get notified every single time we go live, and you can join the conversation in the chat room. We got a couple people in there. Tony from Canada's here, Jim McGuinn, and
Jim McGuinn.
Yeah, you know, that is what it is. Or if you are listening and you want to watch the video, go find me on YouTube and subscribe, and you can watch the video back as well, because there's a more comedic element to the video, mostly just looking at Paul.
I was about to say, come on, let's be serious.
Yeah, but hey, Paul, I'm proud of you, because the birthday balloons are gone.
No, they're not.
I moved them.
No, they're not.
I was like, I can't physically have these balloons here because it's not, it's past that point. It's not the birthday month anymore. So I literally go, these can't be on, and I threw them on the other side of the computer.
Yeah. You know, we talk about, you know, like going back to the old stuff. Was there any stuff that was left over, old demos that you guys took and like over the years that you guys might have taken and massaged to bring into a current sound?
Old demos. What was it? What the fuck did we put out? Did we put out that Old Habits Die Hard thing in 2019, Todd?
Yeah, but it wasn't, we didn't update anything. We just threw it out.
No, fuck that. Yeah.
But there was, you know, we've talked about this before. There was a set of demos when we were trying to work on the third record for Geffen, when shit was starting to fall apart. We did a series of demos. I think it was three different sessions.
And yeah.
We had those, but we got dropped. They never got released until we kind of curated this. I don't know. There what was maybe 28, 30 songs, including covers, but yeah. We curated that, and that came out in the Old Habits.
You know? I mean, at this day and age, you're never sitting down and writing 30 songs now.
No.
You're no way. Yeah.
No, but Geffen was, I mean, they were just pushing us, you know?
Yeah, right? Oh, no, really.
Right. Yeah.
Right.
The fact that you made it to three records on Geffen even then was a big accomplishment.
Yeah, given. I consider it. Yeah, it was.
Yeah, I mean,
no, it was, at that point in time, it was fantastic because during the third record, well, I mean, the third record never came out until Acetate put it out 3 years ago. But I mean, during that time when we were doing the demos, I mean, we were doing demos with producers that did like, you know, L7.
Yeah,
you know, and producers that did, you know, Beck, you know, stuff like that. I mean, these were demos. And it was like, you're showing us, to go back in history in the band, our very first demos that we did in 1987 were with a guy named Matt Wallace, who was, he had just got done with some band called The Replacements doing an album called Don't Tell a Soul. I was like, what the fuck? And it's like, you know, once we did those demos, it's like, well, we figured, well, this is the guy we're going to do the record. But it's like, no. This is just your interim producer until you get to the next level, until we can, you know, and then at that point, it's payola, cocaine, and everything else. But
yeah, the good stuff.
But absolutely, booger sugar. But with this latter part, I mean, it's a little different now, and you got to think a little more smart, you know. And regarding producers and all this stuff, it's like, I mean, we don't really have to think about producers because we have one in the band. Yeah. I mean, it's his full time job. He's a musical supervisor, producer, songwriter. So I think that's where we get maybe a little one up on other bands because we don't have to spend a bunch of time doing pre-production. We just like literally go in and record, blam, done. And then go from there. But, you know.
Plus the price is right.
Yeah, price doesn't suck. Yeah.
Do you ever long for that outside opinion? Like, do you ever wonder what if you had somebody else coming in? Or are you at that point where you're so comfortable you don't need that outside opinion?
No, I mean, for me personally, I don't think, I like bouncing it like, after the fact.
Okay.
And I wouldn't be opposed to having somebody come in, but it'd have to be somebody really close that we trust, you know.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's where I'm at. I don't know.
It's gotta be someone who, let's be honest, it's gotta be someone cheap because we all know how much money record labels are paying for albums today.
Right. Yeah, so, yeah. But
I don't mean that sarcastically. I'm just
it's truth. It's truth. Yeah.
Like, you know, right now. We are totally DIY. We get a small budget to do the record. We can't go out and hire like a big name.
Yeah.
But in the meantime, we're very confident with Tim's ability to, you know, he knows the band and he knows our strengths and weaknesses. And I think we all do, you know, and it works out pretty good.
That's awesome. We're lucky. We're lucky.
Go ahead, Paul.
I think they were talking.
We're not.
I'm trying to be polite. That's
that's not going to work.
Why?
Here.
Trying.
Yeah.
Trying. Why?
Work here. Why start now?
What the fuck? Really?
You're going to hell already, brother.
I got all my Izzy bashing out before we started.
Brilliant.
How important is the live element for you guys?
Oh, everything. It's everything.
It's
us. I mean, you know, you can shove us in the studio. You can record us live. We've tried it every which way but loose. It doesn't work out. But when you, the live element is us. I mean, it's.
That's what keeps me going.
Yeah.
It's, you know, you get out there and we, you know, we deal with all the bullshit that happens before and after, but that 1 hour that we're on stage, because we're old and we can only do an hour, but every once in a while, maybe an hour and 5 minutes. But
I like to look at it this way. You can only do an hour because most of your fans have to get home to pay the babysitters.
Yeah.
And they don't want
to hear the B-sides either.
Yeah, right.
B-sides like,
because the minute you start a B-side, they go, all right, we can leave now and miss traffic.
Yeah, the shows where we go on at 9 are a lot better than the ones at 11.
Although the ones at 11 are a lot looser.
Yeah. But going back live, there are some weird shit that goes on that, you know, but one of the fun things for me is driving somewhere with the guys, you know, and shit. And that's always been a great part about being in this band was the camaraderie, and we're all friends, and it's fun to get out on the road and hang out with the guys, you know. So we'll get in little tips where someone gets in a bad mood, but it's comedy, and we listen to great music. I play DJ and take requests up front, and I sit up front because I got long legs. I get a smoke, but yeah, just that part of it's really cool too. That you know, and also we get to go places for free a lot of times. You know, you get to see certain cities and eat, and so
not
a bad. And then sometimes we actually get paid to go out of. Well, that all depends.
Now you're being crazy.
Sometimes we come back and we actually make $50.
Hey, what about that? Where's that money?
You know,
the
thing that I really liked when at the Viper Room show, you guys were just out hanging out. I mean, you saw all the pictures from the Kiss meet and greets with the behind plexiglass, like statues, you know, you guys are like, well, fuck it, man. Let's say hi to the people.
Yeah.
We're a bar band. And what does a bar band do when they're not playing at a bar? Well, they're smoking outside of the bar because you can't smoke inside the bar. So that's us. We're a bar band. You know, and those that don't smoke, well, they're doing other shit behind outside, you know. So, and we're a bar band, and that's it, you know.
Which brings me to the quote that I found. I make car parts for the American working man because that's what I am, and that's what I care about.
Yes, that's it. That's it. You got it. Tommy Boy quote. Yes.
That was the Tommy Boy quote. Damn it.
Such a good one.
We're a bar band. We're at the bar because we
exactly.
the
bar. We're at the bar. We're taking orders for fucking new transmissions and new fucking clutches.
Oh, speaking of, you're trying
to find somebody who fixes clutches because yours can't get into the next city.
That's no shit.
Tony in the chat room just posted that that as well, which is funny and ironic that you said it as he posted it. Here's a question from Sledgehammer, who's great to have back. I haven't seen Sledgehammer here on the live stream in a little while. He goes, have you ever written a song in your dreams or woken up with something?
That's kind of weird.
I woke up with a lot of things.
I think ZZ Top woke up with wood.
We woke up with, I don't know, crabs at Red Rocks. I don't know. we played Red Rocks, and my fucking drum tech comes up to me, and he's like, dude, what is this? And he goes into his fucking jeans and pulls this thing out, and it's like, bam, bam, bam. I'm like, oh, that's the only thing we've ever pulled.
Saber-tooth crotch crickets.
Oh, wow.
Wow is right.
You remember that, Todd, right? The fucking band had to get, or the bus had to get steam cleaned and all that shit.
I think Todd was trying to forget that before you brought it up again.
good time.
Oh, boy. Wow.
And is the drum tech still with you, more importantly?
No, but I'm still really good friends with him.
Yeah. We give a shit to this day.
Drum tech, I am the drum tech. Fuck, I'm the drum tech and the merch guy.
What's a tech?
Oh, fucking yeah. What, tech? What's that?
Yeah.
Hey, you know what? Those, that's the bar band thing.
Yep. Yeah, we're a bar band. We load our shit in, load it out. Hopefully we have somebody to sell merch so we can make money to buy beer and get gas for the next town. That's about it.
See, that's why you got to hit the strip club at the bar the night before and find one of the strippers to be the merch gal, because sex
you
sells
sell a lot more.
That's right.
Holy mackerel. Yes, indeed. Our merch guy's pretty sexy.
Izzy, I think if you tie the shirt down at your belly, right above your belly button, you could sell a bunch of merch. I think social experiment, next Junkyard show, Izzy should sell merch.
Hey, I was merch bitch for LA Guns in St. Cloud, and I sold a lot of merch.
I bet you.
So can you, Izzy, can you, the next LA show, can you dress up like Buffalo Bill and sell our merch?
That'll just be like any other Tuesday for Izzy.
Yeah, any other Tuesday.
It'll rub the t-shirt on it.
Depends what part of West Hollywood you guys are playing in.
Well, it's maybe the Viper Room. So.
Voice down.
Live at Trunks.
Live at Manhole.
You know, it's funny because
fantastic.
Eddie Trunk told me that he walked into that bar once not knowing it was Boys Town. He just saw Trunks. He's like, oh shit, a bar with my name on it. He ordered a drink, and then he took a look around
and he stayed all night.
He moved in right next door.
And then Don Jameson walked in, and they hung out until they met.
I was hanging there. Don Jameson showed up. Florentine's outside laughing at us.
Oh, there's Ace Bob Johnson right over there.
Yeah. He must have got kicked out of the Rainbow. This is his new bar.
Ooh-wee.
Now, did you guys have, not to bring it back to work, but before we have to hear the song, did you have multiple options for the B-side, or was this, what did you know you were pairing these two songs? Is there a reason why you paired these songs together, or was it because you had two songs? You had two songs and you liked Life or More?
No, that's a good question. Actually, correct me if I'm wrong, Todd, the B-side on this single was actually going to be a slower song. Was going to be kind of not a ballad, because who the fuck wants to hear like, oh, we're doing a ballad? It's like, oh, you know, every rose has it is thorn. No thanks. No, it was a very slow tempo song, and so we kind of rethought everything, and then Tim and Brian, I think, came up with Last of a Dying Breed, and it's such a good compliment, the B side to the A side to the single. Because we are the last of a dying breed. We're the, you know, working class stiffs that don't take ourselves seriously. We know what we're doing. We know we're not going to make $1 million at this. We know we're not going to make $1,000 at this. Well, we may make 500 at it, but that's fine with us. But we are the last of a dying breed, and we're fucking old. You know, we're between 50 and 60 years old. And you know,
by the way, we're not old.
We're age appropriate. But I mean, once that song came into play, it was like, oh fuck, we got to jump in the studio. And the good thing about that was, it was right when as far as virus goes, it was at the end of last year when things were going low. So we're like, fuck it, put our mask on, go in the studio, knock this out. And we knocked it out in an hour, 2 hours. And then the way Tim does everything, he does everything on the computer at home. So it worked out really well. But I'm glad that that Last of a Dying Breed came as the B-side, because the original, I think the original verse, the original slower tempo song would have been good. But it's a great compliment to the single, definitely.
I think, and I might be wrong, but I think it was also that it was further along than the other things that we had at the time.
Yeah.
This is kind of, but Pat's right. It's a nice compliment, you know, thematically for sure.
Either way you go, honestly, Last of a Dying Breed or Lifer, they could be the A side. I mean, they both have the same message.
And that's, you know, lyrically. Kind of what I was going to say, because it's almost, I mean, the B side, obviously when you have your vinyl today and you have to flip it over, it's the B side, but with everything being so digital, you people are getting two songs and you can't,
yeah.
You know, it's not like it's 1989 and you know, Lifer's going to radio and no one's ever going to listen to the B side. It's not like that.
Right.
They're going to hear both songs.
Yeah.
Yeah. They better both be good. And they both are very good.
Thank you. Thanks, Paul.
Thank you.
Is there going to be a 45 or are you guys going to wait until you put the whole thing?
No, there is a 45. The 45.
Come on, Izzy, do your homework. Sorry.
basically, it's one of those things that the acetaterecords.com or acetate.com, you can go there, you can order it. It's on either black splatter vinyl or blue vinyl. The 45, they will be shipping as soon as acetate gets them in the house. But when you have Dark Side of the Moon on vinyl and you have Junkyard Lifer on vinyl, which one is going to be shoved out of the studio, out of the pressing plant first, kind of thing?
For the record,
so
nobody can get vinyl made right now. It is insane.
It's very hard.
The problem is everything. All the for those people listening at home who and I'm we're going to be talking about vinyl a lot with Danko Jones. I think
absolutely
it is. And I'm obsessed with vinyl. I'm the one thing this shutdown did was it expanded. I like tripled my vinyl collection because I just sat home all day buying vinyl. But the
fucking rad.
It's all everybody fell behind. The plants had to shut down, so now they're all behind on production. And it's not like you could print vinyl faster. It's just
you can't.
It's not like you can buy another computer and print more CDs. It's like vinyl. You're on a timeline.
Yeah. And we're looking at and the good thing is because he put in the order so early. That we're like second or third up on the queue. And as far as the test pressing goes, test pressings are sorted out, everything's done. So I think he's basically about 2 weeks away from receiving vinyl.
Oh, nice.
Now the CDs that people ordered, those are going out exactly on the release date on Friday, if not sooner. And then the same thing with the swag that we sell on the website, the live for t-shirts and all that, those are going out prior to, those are going out after we get back from the Fresno, San Francisco run. So
that's my other, I love the bands right now that are like the big thing now. I've also been buying a lot of swag online. Another thing is the pre-orders now, like everybody's like doing the pre-orders and you'll get it when you get it. I'm still waiting for my Foo Fighters DG's cocaine mirror that hasn't showed up yet. They put out for that Bee Gees cover album they did. They have a cocaine mirror that comes. They like sold a cocaine mirror on their website. You know, one of those 70s that you get at the fair when you can pop four balloons. One of those. I was like, I'll take four.
So my question would be to that is, do you get four balloons worth of cocaine with the mirror?
That would actually be, that question comes from a guy with a song named Hollywood, I guess.
From somebody that when you're at a certain age, you know what balloons mean. So.
Yeah, right. Oh, and for the record, Ace Von Johnson said that was just that one time in college that he ended up at that bar in Boys Town.
With Eddie Trunk.
Don't.
As opposed to in Eddie's trunk.
Oh boy.
Wow.
Yep.
Oh my God.
Anyone that waited till exactly 5:55 to tune in to hear the premiere got that.
I got that. Perfect.
So but right before we play the song, so you guys are out this weekend. And what else do you got coming up?
After this weekend, we're going to be probably, I think we got some time off until December, and then we'll be in Austin at Austin City Limits, Dallas at a place, or Fort Worth, a place called the Rail Club, and then in Eagle Pass, a place called Cooters.
Nice.
In December. There's going to be some dates possibly before that, but we're still working on that. So our next dates after this weekend are December in, Texas.
Rail Club's a good place.
Club's a great place. Great people. Love them to death,
Good sounding room.
Yeah, great room. Great people. Great bar.
Beautiful. All right. So you guys ready for this?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's get this thing out.
Let's get it out. Let me hit this so I can hit the post. Patrick Mazingo and Todd Muscat in studio from Junkyard right here on another FN podcast, broadcasting live from beautiful downtown Burbank, California. This song is what you have been waiting for. It is live right here, right now. It is the brand new Junkyard, and we are going to hit the post, ladies and gentlemen. Todd Muscat, Patrick Mazingo, thank you very much. This song is called Lifer. Hey, wait a minute. The music stopped. Oh, that's right, because we're on YouTube, and I don't want the show to get flagged. So, if you do want to hear the world premiere of Lifer, head on over to your favorite audio place to get podcasts and download Metal Edge magazines and other effing podcasts with Junkyard and Danko Jones. And come to the exact moment of the show, and you will get it. Or you should just go ahead. Go to Spreaker.com/user/Izzy Presley. That's me right over here. And hit that follow button. And when you do, you will find out exactly when we go live every week. And you can contribute to the show. You can get in that chat room. You can join the party. Anyways, here's Danko Jones. That was Lifer right here on Metal Edge Magazines, another FM podcast. The world premiere from Junkyard, brand new, comes out this Friday. I haven't put on radio guy voice in a long time.
Like, literally, Izzy, I was everything in my power not to stop you and just be like, oh my God. like you're back at the strip club, like about to introduce Savannah on the side stage with your own band single. Like, that's what that was like.
Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together and dollars on the stage for, well, joining us right now, Danko Jones.
Hey guys,
how are you doing, brother?
Hey Patrick. Hey Todd.
Hey
Izzy.
Hi.
How you doing, man?
Good to meet you in person. Sort of.
Sort of.
Sort of.
This is the new in person.
This is the new in person.
Yeah. I didn't realize you guys knew each other. You have history.
Yeah.
We played 4 great shows with these guys.
It was just a happy coincidence when we said we could couple these 2 stellar beacons of rock and roll power on the show together.
This is the stellar man of rock and roll, Danko, right there, man.
The last shows we played before the pandemic were with Todd and Patrick, Junkyard and us in California. Yep. So it was very memorable. We didn't know how memorable, but it turned out to be very memorable.
Have you guys done any shows?
Yeah, we've done 3 shows so far, and you guys have done, I saw it on Instagram.
We did five shows. We did 2 in LA and 3 in the Midwest, yeah.
Oh, yeah, I didn't go.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Midwest for you guys. That's a long trek. Did you guys fly out there?
Yeah, flew in. Yeah. Had a opening act, you know, sort us out and all that stuff. It was interesting. It was a blast, you know. It was a lot of, like, you know, stay the fuck away kind of thing, but with the crowd. But very respectful for the crowd. The crowd was very respectful, and, you know, people were masking up and stuff, so. It was fun, but by the way, the live stream that y'all did about a week and a half ago, fantastic. Oh my God. Oh, I kept watching it over and over. It was so good. The new album is really good. I emailed you about my favorite track, so.
And I've been
awesome. I'm going to go fold some laundry. I'll be back in the
Yeah, let Patrick and Todd do the interview. This is great.
I love
it. It's funny. It was funny because
we're doing this every week now.
Yeah, I love it. No, I'm like, Ace Von Johnson has been bugging me for a while to get Danko on, and I'm glad it's finally happened. And I figured, fuck, he's going to come on. We'll talk about the new record for a little bit, then just talk about Kiss and Vinyl for a half an hour, you know?
Sure. I just want to say, since I got Todd and Patrick here, I cut from the same cloth helped me through the pandemic right at the top. I would listen to that song every morning.
Aw, thanks, man. Thank you.
What was
it? I think your whole catalog helped me through the pandemic, honestly.
Thank you. I'm curious, why?
well, Well, I mean, aside from the music, I really dug the lyrics that David was singing. So
yeah, that's what kind of, excellent.
That's what got me too. So
nice.
Well, we should talk about the new record. It's called Power Trio. It is out now. Is this something you've been working on over the pandemic? Was this something you were working on beforehand and then got postponed?
Yeah, we started writing, like, I think we were about a week or week and a half into writing before the shutdown. And then about five or six of those riffs, not songs, but riffs, got made it to the album. But we wrote the whole album in isolation from one another during the pandemic. So that's what happened. But yeah, you know, what are you going to do? You got to keep going. And we've got tour dates for next year and tour dates for this year. I think you guys all know, like, you just got to book it and see what happens. We don't know what's going to happen. So
it's tough. I was just in Cincinnati with one of my artists, and I manage bands full time. I just do this so I can annoy Izzy once a week, but the,
you do it well, Bubby.
But yeah, it's crazy because too, once you get around, it's, you know, some places it's literally like nothing's ever happened. In other places you can't play. I mean, it's nuts.
Yeah, there isn't a kind of all around, but I think in the music industry, I think people in bands know that in order for this to, for shows to happen again, everybody's got to get on board, man.
Well, that I find the problem tends to be, from what I've seen, the bands are all on board. They're getting there. The ones that aren't are realizing. And look, I mean, in a lot of ways, someone like AEG stepping in and saying you're not playing if you're not vaccinated, that has a big part of it. But it's a lot of the fans too, because it's a lot of the fans that are just coming out and just don't care and they don't get it. And that's it. I was talking to somebody this weekend about it, how when you've got a band that wants to come out and say hi, you can't come out and say hi to people who aren't vaccinated, because then you're backstage and you pass something off to you're the opener. You pass something off to the headliner. It's like, it's that easy. And it's just, it affects how everybody does their, although I do love, somebody mentioned this before. Someone was flipping through her phone, showing me meet and greet pictures, and it was her and then two Road Cases and Billy Idol. And then there was another one that was like, and there was another one of like a guy and then 6 feet and then Chris and Rich Robinson. And I'm like, all right, the meet and greets. I love the dedication to the VIP meet and greets that they're not giving those up. They're going, nope, just two Road Cases in between.
The Kiss one will always be the best with the plexiglass. It's like they're in an aquarium and you're going through the zoo.
It's like they're in a penalty. Yes. It's they're in a penalty box.
Are they cased completely in plexiglass?
No, it's just a plexiglass in between them. I think between them and the and the.
I think
fans.
To be fair, I think Gene's hair has been in plexiglass for like.
Fiberglass.
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 Oh man!
No, but yeah, no, it's definitely interesting out there though, and it's like it feels really good to be out there, and it also feels weird sometimes. It's just it's real. It's an interesting. We're going through an interesting time right now.
Yeah.
So how did putting out a record? How does it feel putting out a record in the midst of all this? I mean, this is not your normal album cycle. You in the rock world, we support by playing shows. I mean, how does it feel?
It's weird, obviously, but we do have shows booked. I mean, we've been playing every 2 weeks. It's not the usual like release and go and storm everywhere, but we've got a little tour booked in December, and we've got a giant tour booked in April to June next year. So yeah, I don't know. It's okay. It's frustrating because, you know, you want to go out and do all the shows, but Murphy's Law, like this album is the one album that's doing actually better than the ones we put out in the last 10 years. So it's very frustrating, but at the same time,
hey Danko, do you guys recently like really did like you hit the charts in Germany pretty hard, right?
Yeah, we were number one with a single in Germany, like the national rock charts. Wow. And then we just found out 2 days ago, it's the album itself is number 16 on the national charts.
Wow.
And we're, yeah, but I'm home in Toronto. Like we should right. be, we yeah. should be touring Germany.
You should be right in now. Germany, right?
Yeah, yeah we should right. be.
In Germany. Oh, I'm sorry, Danko. I'm sorry. I forgot that you're from Toronto. I don't know if you heard that or not.
I did. Yeah. It's what all you Americans
I was about to say.
Chops on.
He looks about as amused by it as I am by it every week when you do it.
I know. But
and
look,
I'm not Canadian.
Look, I'm from Minnesota, which is basically South Canada.
Oh, my
anyway,
God. So you guys are worse than us.
Yeah.
I know. Your accents. Give me a break. Wasn't there a movie based on your accent called Fargo?
Yeah.
Come on.
Right.
Oh, Izzy meets his match. Here we go.
That's all right. I get it from the dwarves all the time, so it's all good.
The dwarves? The killer dwarves or the dwarves?
The killer dwarves.
The seven ones or the...
the seven ones. The seven ones.
But your friends...
But they're not original members.
Drunky.
They're not original members.
All right.
So when does the podcast start, Izzy?
Oh, we're live right now, baby.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Todd and Patrick just decided to stick around. So,
well, it's great to see them because they were the last band that we saw before we were shut down, and that's why I was saying, like, you know, from those four shows. It usually when you do a tour and you come home, you end up listening to the band that you just toured with. And that's how it started. The pandemic started for me. When I think of the pandemic, I'll always think of Junkyard, but that doesn't mean that it's a bad thing
in a bad way. Yeah.
In a good way. That's what I meant. But that's how we started our pandemic isolation, is like finishing those shows off. And then thinking was that show with Junkyard the last show we ever played as a band? Like, we were thinking
that was right at the time where there was reports, oh, there's this virus in China and people, you know, there's some concern. It hadn't even blown up, but there was a little bit of a bubbling up through the news.
Yeah, I heard that in December, but it was so far away, and it was just, oh, they usually tie these things up in a few weeks, it'll be
yeah exactly. I think we said earlier, we'll just flatten the curve. We'll be back out in 3 weeks. This is fine. We got this.
Danko, sorry. Are you going to be able to get out of Canada?
Yeah, we're not. Canadians are not off the safe list like Americans are.
Yeah. We're the responsible country.
We're actually highly vaccinated. Of course, we have our pockets and, you know, they're blocking hospitals right now, but we're doing actually pretty good in terms of vaccination rates and stuff. So I'm hoping we can, you know, Ireland and Denmark are like, they're and Sweden are dropping all their COVID restrictions very soon, if not already.
Right.
So because we're so highly vaccinated, I think it should be okay, but I don't know.
Things change really fast.
Yeah, because Daniel DK was just down there. I just saw him a couple weeks ago.
Oh, he was at Psycho Las Vegas, right?
Yeah. Then he said, fuck it, I'm staying for an extra day. And he drove down to L.A. here. So he went to the Rainbow. You know, and I haven't seen him since the Monsters of Rock cruise. You know,
I just saw him 2 days ago. Well, we live in the same city.
Yeah. It will happen. No, I was just kind of curious to see, you know, as far as the touring goes, if you were going to be able to get out of the country.
Well, so far, there's no shows for us booked outside until April 2022.
Oh, okay.
So I'm just hoping, like we all are, that hoping, betting on the, you know, things being taken care of by April. And if not, and we have to cancel, everybody knows why, and we don't have to, you know, deal with comments online or anything.
Yeah. You said earlier, when you didn't realize the podcast had started because it was absolute nonsense.
I was joking. I knew it was on.
I was joking with Izzy. This is all nonsense all the time. This is what we do. I gotta say, this one can go for another 3 hours because I'm having fun.
Probably.
Oh, yeah.
But you mentioned it was, you know, you wrote the album in isolation and you did stuff. I mean, you haven't, I'm imagining it's the first time you've done a record like that. Was the approach, was the approach just harrowing, or did you like, we just do what we have to do and we'll figure it out?
I was really skeptical at first. And I think out of the three, I'm the most with the most anxiety about it. Mm-hmm. And I was really skeptical we could even pull it off because we're so used to jamming like for hours in front of each other. But the first song that we wrote from beginning to end was like kind of kicked our butts. I was so surprised. So that's what gave me the confidence to keep going. And plus, you know, like there's nothing to do. Like tomorrow, like I was using really old equipment, out of date equipment, and it would crash. My computer would crash every like 15 minutes, but who cares? Like there's nothing. I can wait. You know, what would you normally take 5 minutes? We're sometimes taking an hour. Mm-hmm. Who cares? Like I got nothing to do tomorrow. I'll just do it tomorrow. So, you know, that's what happened. So it was okay. You know, there's no clock to watch really.
Yeah.
So.
Which actually,
and as well as, you know, being stuck at home, it's like, you know, you're listening to a lot of stuff and probably a lot of different stuff. No, not at all.
I created, that's why I'm saying cut from the same cloth, the one song, because I was just making these playlists to keep myself positive, thinking positively. I created these playlists. I would listen to it in the morning, just like really nice feel good songs that made me feel good, but I was not checking out new albums or anything. And then when you have to submit like your top 10 of the year, we've done that before. Yeah. I submitted all comedy records because I wasn't listening to anything new from bands. I didn't listen to any new music. Junkyard's album was probably one of the few albums I listened to that was a new album or a newish type of album, but no, I didn't listen to anything.
It's kind of a, and just for fans, it's tough for them to realize, but it's really a bummer when you're immersed in the business, knowing what we were going through and knowing how hard, because it's just, you're sitting here going, you want to listen to new stuff and you know it's not going to get the chance that you want it to get. You know that it's a real, just weird world. So it's fantastic. Your album's great, and I'm really glad you got to get it out. I feel like we're ready for new music now. I was saying earlier.
Yeah, I'm starting to listen to new music again. So that
was good. Earlier, one of the biggest things that kept me going through all this, my vinyl collection, I was literally just be online all day going through eBay, looking at like Discogs, just literally, that's all I did through the pandemic.
I sold 300 records during the pandemic.
I probably bought about 100.
I just sold it all. I was just, I didn't really want to listen to anything. I sold 300 records.
Wow. You didn't sell any of your Kiss records, did you?
Sorry.
You didn't 1% of your collection.
Sorry?
Go ahead, Izzy.
Oh, I was just saying, you didn't sell any of your Kiss records, did you?
No, of course not.
I didn't sell any Kiss records. No.
Good.
I had a double of Kiss Alive. I sold that. Kiss Alive 2. I had a double, so I sold that.
Yeah. That's. I think I've got about 6 Alive 2s right now. I'm just too lazy to actually sell them. So that's the, like, I'm literally, I have a stack in the corner of like, nobody needs 6 Alive 2s.
No.
Although.
Oh.
Uh-oh. Show and tell time.
Out of frame.
Really good.
Show and tell time.
I think I told this story on the air once. The house I grew up in, my parents were renovating, right? So I was just in Connecticut. My Kiss Alive 2 book.
Oh, wow. That's fell pretty
between
cool,
the dude. Sink and the wall in my bathroom as a kid. And it was pretty much in perfect shape. It got it just perfect shape, and I got it now. So now my Alive 2 is complete.
That's pretty cool.
That was my Kiss detour. Nice. Now Izzy can tell us how great the Peter Criss solo record is, and we can move on with it.
No, it definitely is. Peter Criss's solo record is the best album of the four solo records, and that's the bottom line, because I said so. Not the best Kiss record, the best album. Top to bottom, the Peter Criss solo record. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to get into this next week. The very next Drunken Summit, Portnoy, Benante, Roy Mayorga, and probably Trunk will be back. And we're going track versus track versus track versus track. The solo records, it is going to be amazing. And also, ironically, in celebration of the solo records coming out on the 18th, my version of Speed Back to My Baby is also getting released on the 18th.
Did you say Peter Criss's solo album is the best of the four?
Oh, yes. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Wait, and they're being released on the 18th? No, what, is there bonus stuff?
No, no, no. That's the release.
It's the anniversary of their release.
Oh, okay.
Yes, but I'm releasing.
Is there even more to the Peter Criss album?
Because if that's the case, there absolutely should be. No, I was just saying that I'm releasing Speeding Back to My Baby, my version, on the 18th.
Oh, you're well. This is a great time for me to plug my other band.
Please.
I've had this band for about, I think, 7 years or 8 years. It's called Criss. It's spelled K-R-I-S-S, and I just do Peter Criss ballads.
That is amazing.
And
picture disc. Ooh, picture disc good.
I don't know about picture that. Disc. But Peter Criss, it's me and this woman, Maxine. She passed away a few years back, and she would play piano and I would sing. And now we still have yet to do our first gig, but I've recruited as the new keyboardist/pianist, Dizzy Reed.
Really?
Wow. Yes.
Wow. Nice.
Me and Dizzy are in Criss together.
Very cool.
Yeah. We just do ballads. So it's called Beth Ballads and Beyond. Criss, Beth Ballads and Beyond.
That's fucking brilliant. Right. And please, please tell me you're not busting our balls about this. And this is actually true.
Absolutely not.
Fantastic.
I mean, let me find it on YouTube. My, some of the videos are up on YouTube and
Awesome.
I'll tag everyone. I knew you were a Kiss geek, but I didn't realize you were that big of a Kiss geek. God bless you.
I also proved that Peter Criss died in 1978.
You did.
I did. And you can watch that online. It's a 1 hour lecture. So
holy
1 hour. I watched that.
Wow. That's why Peter Criss's solo album isn't really as good as you think it is.
It's so not really low. Peter.
I got a fire.
Todd is done. Todd is over. Todd is out.
I am. Hold on.
Todd has had enough.
I can find this on YouTube, right?
I mean, does this seriously rival the Paul is Dead conspiracy with the Beatles?
It doesn't rival it. It's better than the Paul is Dead conspiracy because it's real.
The cat's dead. There's
the cat is dead.
Here we go.
That's done.
Todd had enough. Todd has had enough. Todd's
done. You get to a certain age and our bladders turn into teenage girls.
Oh Lord.
Yeah, Danko, your Peter Criss tribute band makes my Ace Frehley tribute band look like a booger. So bless your heart.
But Jesus Christ, is that a good double bill?
Yeah.
Whoa.
Oh,
I like that. Oh, I like that. Ack.
Is that the name of your band?
Ack. Criss. Yeah. That's Criss and Ack. That's
genius. That's actually pretty genius.
Thank you.
Ack. That's pretty good.
The new that t-shirts. I had somebody make up the Ack logo with the Alive 2 colored letters. It looks fucking gold.
Ack and Criss.
I love
Ack
it.
Criss.
I love it.
Oh wow! I've got the YouTube lecture queued up, by the way. So that will be
it's good.
That will
it's
be my
really thanks,
Patrick. Thanks, Patrick.
It's really good. I think I've watched it 3 or 4 times, like really late at night, like after massive amounts of whatever.
I want to know what that whatever is.
Yeah, after massive amounts of shit. After massive amounts of ack.
Yes, no, not ack. Gack, but ack.
Ack.
I'm too old to do gack. Jesus Christ, I'll have a heart attack.
No, I said ack.
The other ack.
I really do feel like we should talk about Danko's album just a little bit.
We should.
Just a wee bit, because that was.
There's 11 songs on it.
All right, there we talked about it.
There we go. Oh, Phil Campbell's on it from Motorhead.
So really?
Really?
Yeah, he's nice. On the last song.
I had no idea.
Yeah, so he's on the last song, so it was nice to have Phil on. Well, it was called Power Trio. So we've, you know, JC, our bass player, he was like, well, why don't we get the guitarist from the, you know, arguably the greatest power trio that ever was to be on an album we're going to call Power Trio. And right. So we reached out to Phil, and he was down. So.
Did you have a prior relationship with him?
Yes. Yeah. We've toured with Motorhead and
okay.
Yeah. Played many shows with them, and yeah, Phil's all the guys were always cool with us, and it's great. And even during the pandemic, I did a quarantine jam with Mickey D.
Okay.
We did.
Oh,
yeah. Right. So we did Iron Fist. I think we did Iron Fist. So you can find it online too. So
that's awesome.
Very nice. Very nice.
Yeah, I want to do one with Todd and Patrick. Let's go.
Absolutely, we're here.
Now,
let's do it.
What,
hey, Danko? Sorry. Go ahead.
No, go.
No, go, I was going to ask. I was going to ask when you guys did Power Trio. Was it during the, when you started to record it, was it during the pandemic, and did you guys do it separately, or did you guys go in the same room together?
Yeah. So we,
that was literally, I was actually,
so was it?
I swear to God, I was going to ask if they ever got into the room together, or if the whole thing was done in isolation. So we're good.
Yeah, we got it. Okay. You and me, Paul. Bye, Izzy.
Hey, I'm fine. I'm just watching the chat room, and they're talking about how they're finding the record and giving it 5 stars. So,
it isn't. Cool. No, 5 stars is not enough for Power Trio, honestly.
Thanks.
Thank you. It's such a good record. I listen to it every day. It's a fantastic record. But anyhow, did you guys go in at the same time or separately? Or
yeah, we wrote it separately, and then we rehearsed it in a room together with partitions. So I never even saw those guys. Oh, but in the studio, we all wore masks and we all kind of kept separate. We did the drums in a different studio. I don't know if that's a normal thing, but we've done that on all our records.
Makes sense.
Right. Yeah. According to the producer's taste, like sometimes they have a particular room that they love for drums, as you probably know.
Patrick. Oh yeah. Yeah,
I don't understand, but it's a studio. It's a studio, for God's sakes. I don't.
It's
get
ceiling
it.
Height. That's all it is. Ceiling height, and depending upon the producer, cocaine intake. But whatever. That's it. That's a whole different. That's a whole different subject.
But we kept the people in the studio low, and around September, October, in Ontario here in Canada, it was under 300 cases a day. So guidelines allowed, I think, 6 in a room together. So we were 5, and then
perfect.
You know, and then as the session goes on, there's less and less people needed. So, so that's how we did it. We were still like together, but we would wear masks, and I would social distance in the studio too. So,
absolutely, yeah, yeah.
I'm a little, you know, after, you know, you're doing an 8-hour day in the studio, it gets hard to just keep distance. But I had a few lapses, but I really tried to keep like 6 feet away all day long.
It's hard to keep that up.
Yeah, it is.
No, it is hard. Especially, I mean, you know, Todd and I both know how, you know, you and Rich and JC are together. So it's very hard to like stay separate from each other. You're talking 6 feet. When you're in a band together, I can't imagine being in a trio together, because we're in a quintet together. Being 6 feet away from each other is very difficult when you're in that emotional setting of recording, because, you know, you really want to just be close to this person, but all of a sudden you've got this rule implied upon you, but you want to be safe, because the last thing you want to, you know, do is infect him or infect yourself. So, but for what you guys did, and it sounds like it was a kind of a rough recording situation. It sounded like you guys were in this room together. playing, and it's, I mean, it's just so tight and perfect and fantastic.
Thanks.
Such a great album. Really good album.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot. It means a lot coming from you guys, because I mean, you know, you go, I mean, it's great to hear it from you guys. I just
think maybe I missed
the world of you guys. So
thank you, Danko. Maybe I missed it, but when you guys recorded it, you guys were all in the same room at the same time and could see each other, or you couldn't see each other?
When we rehearsed it, so we would we finally said, okay, you know, studio's 2 weeks away, we got to rehearse these things. So the only place to go is our rehearsal room, which is just a room. Mm-hmm. So right. JC actually came in and he put partitions up, and we have two rooms, and he was in the second room. He had a hard time like keeping up because there's a bit of a lag.
Yeah.
And it was me and Rich, drums and guitar and vocals in one room. And we had a partition, and then there was a door. It was weird, and then we would just, you know, yell at each other, like, how is that, you know, take it over, or let's do that. Like double the, it was like that.
Yeah.
It was weird, but it was okay. We ended up, everything was okay. You know, worked out.
And when you guys go into the studio to record, do you track with Rich? You just and then put your pieces in later?
Yeah. So the way we, like our producer, Eric Ratz, he likes to get us all in the studio. So we were in the big room in the studio. Right. We were all in there together, and we laid down our tracks for Rich while Rich was playing.
Gotcha.
And then we moved the session into another studio so you can just do drums over our tracks that we had done.
Yeah, that's where I was going.
Yeah, I don't know if people can actually follow that.
Have you ever wanted to go in and record as a live band?
We used to do that when we were broke, you know, like we had 3 hours.
Like every, you
know, yeah, yeah.
Every band, yeah.
Look, but I mean, there's something to be said about that, because you get more of a raw live feel out of it.
Yeah, you do, you know? But
would you, but you prefer, like, because I think like some of the stuff that's recorded like that, it's like there's a rawness about it, you know, and overproduced, overperfected, overdubbed. Sometimes it's like you can't reproduce that live, you know.
I agree with that, but for every recording that's done like that, that's incredible, that's passed down through the ages, that everybody loves,
yes,
there's 1,000 bands that sucked at it.
Yep.
Yes.
Right.
And I also think with the developments we've had in recording and everything, it has gotten easier, or at least there are producers out there that are quite adept at capturing that live rawness without overproducing it and making it sound crappy, which is the other thing. I mean, it's just there's people that you can find that sound without having everybody in.
Yeah, that's true.
The guys that are good at it.
That's true. That's a certain kind of band to do it too.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, right. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And there's this guy on YouTube. He's like the drum doctor or whatever the fuck he is. And like he took Van Halen.
Ringing endorsement right there, by the way.
Yeah.
That's going to go on his press list. Yeah.
The drum doctor or whatever the fuck.
Anybody, anything that starts with drum, it's like, nah.
He took, pardon me. And he took Running with the Devil and he time corrected it. And it just lost all of its feel.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it just lost all of its feel. You know, there's something to be said about looseness.
Well, I personally think I have never, all the years at Metal Edge, were you at Century Media at one point? Were you a Century Media artist at one point in there somewhere?
Me?
Yeah, you.
No, labels don't like us too much. No.
For some reason, I was thinking you were on Century.
No wonder we get along so well. Labels.
But, no, it's just, I have been a fan for a while. It's I never really got to do anything with you back when Metal Edge was a print publication. I think this record's perfectly timed right now, because I think we need music out there, you know, like what Junkyard did, like their single, like Lifer, and like this album, just reminding people that even though we've been locked in our houses, fucking rock is huge, and rock's what gets us through, and we need stuff like this right now. So thank you. It's a I wish you could go out and tour it like you want to immediately, but hopefully people will hear it and they'll be there in spring.
Well, you know, I was complaining for years about touring, and I just wanted a break, and I didn't want it this way. This is not what I wanted. This is not how I wanted a break. So I've started to like want to play shows again, like, you know, like I mean, not shows, but tour again.
Yeah.
Not just, yeah, you know, just not one or two shows here and there. So that's new for me as well, like wanting to tour again.
I've got a question in regards to that. Like, after you've been on the road for like 3 months, so you do your European run, when you come back, obviously you're going to rest for a while. How long does it take for you to get that itch going again to hit the road?
Yeah, never.
Never?
Yeah. Never, no. I don't. Do you guys do that? You guys feel that?
We don't go on 3 month runs. I'm sure we wouldn't. But yeah, I do. I mean, I've been sitting around and bored, you know, I want to go do something, you know, but it's different. We go for a weekend, we fly out for a weekend, we do Friday, Saturday, and come home on a Sunday. You're gone. You're just, you know, your dog, your everyone you love, your favorite restaurants are all back home. So I was just curious if you know, once you're done and you get back into your, you know, back home, if you get that itch, but you don't.
I don't get that itch. I've heard a lot of people do, or most people do. I just never get that itch. I'm glad to be
home. Yeah, I'm sorry.
I'm just glad to be home. Yeah. I really like being home. I don't like touring.
Yeah. Do you get like this, if you don't want to tour, do you start writing, you know, stay busy that way? Or do you kind of just, you know, chill out for a while until you go, okay, now it's time to start again?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't. I don't start writing till someone says start writing. Literally,
it's time.
You start writing. You genuinely don't like tour. It's the, I presume you like playing. It's just the.
Oh, I love playing. Playing is the best.
It's the other 22 hours of the day that just sitting on the road. Yeah.
Like if I could teleport on stage, I would do that.
It's really.
But hanging out with the Junkyard Guys is great. Yeah. I was even saying like, oh, if that was the way to end it, hey,
it's not bad. Yeah,
it's not bad. Something
tells me that with the Junkyard Guys, you probably drank enough to kill anything in your body.
No, not at all. No.
Wow.
No, Danko. I mean, you know, I think the first time we chatted was at Brick by Brick in San Diego, and you were just like, you know, you were in your world. And I was like, the first thing that popped into my mind is like, he's in his world, I'm in mine. I just got off stage. I need to respect his privacy.
Yeah.
And I need to get away from my shit. And then we started talking about, oh my God, like, you know, 19, like punk rock stuff. And then at that point, it was two guys without a bar sitting at a bar talking. And we just started talking with each other. And then at that point, it was like, oh my God, we've got so much in common together. That's a rarity when you're touring with a band. And Danko, I'm sure you guys have had opening acts where it's like you have, you know, you've had conversations and stuff. And we've had many opening acts and headlining acts where we've got along and, you know, here and there. But we had this really good vibe going on where
it was
after we had that chat, it was like the next three or four shows, the next three shows were just like smooth as silk. Oh, my God. It was like, oh, this is great. I mean, we would show up earlier than you guys, and we were like, oh, we're looking forward to like you guys showing up in the van. It was like we were fanboys at that point.
I hope they're safe.
Same with me. I was so looking forward to playing shows with you guys.
But you guys didn't know each other beforehand.
We had mutual respect for each other, I think, you know, at that point. But we didn't know each other like at all.
No.
Personally.
No, I mean, when the shows got announced, I think I posted it on Instagram or something there with the two of us together. I mean, I got phone calls going, holy cow, you're going on tour Junkyard? I'm like, yeah, man. It was like that. Seriously.
We got the same phone calls. It was like, put me on the list. It was like, no.
So how did it happen? I just assumed you guys knew each other from over the years.
I think we had both reached out to each other over the years, and we're both with the same booking agency. That helps out, you know, but over the years it was, you know, can you guys do this? Can you guys do that? Can we do this? And finally for some reason, it worked out that these four West Coast dates worked out well for both of us. And then once we started communicating between myself and Danko, and then myself with Danko vis-a-vis their manager, and your tech at the point, everything just went so smooth. It was like, oh, you guys need this, you need this. Okay, we can supply this. You guys can supply this. It was great. And then as soon as we met up with each other at our first show in San Diego, it was like we both were at a comfortable state with each other as far as bands go. And a lot of opening acts and headlining acts don't have that.
Yeah.
But we both had such respect for each other that it was like, oh, this is the way it's going to work. And we're going to make it work for everyone. However, we can make it work as easy as possible. And those four shows were fantastic. And we shared a merch guy. It was fantastic.
And for years, I would name drop Junkyard in interviews as a band that I looked towards in terms of living in two different worlds at the same time. Like we come from a punk rock background and we're in the hard rock, heavy music world. And can the two worlds exist? And I would always say, well, look at Junkyard. Like Junkyard were always the band that bridged musics together and genres together. And I always felt a kinship to that, to the band, like from that standpoint. So when this happened, I was like very excited. It's funny. One of the people who called me was Damien Abraham from Fucked Up. If you're familiar with that band.
Oh, so Damien.
Damien called me up right away when I posted that Instagram. He's like, holy cow, you're going on tour with Junkyard. I was like, yes, man. Yes. So yeah, he was very excited about it. So yeah, it's cool.
I feel like you guys should, like, when you do your power trio together, you should cover the Love Boat theme or something.
We can do that.
I feel like this is just like, this is such happenstance that you all end up on this together and you guys had all that respect for everybody and everything. It's like,
it's definitely happenstance. I mean, the first time I heard Danko's music and knew about, you know, the band was with my other band, Speed Buggy, because I was touring Europe so much and you guys were in Europe like, oh my God, nonstop.
They're flying everywhere, every city,
everywhere, posters everywhere.
And who's this Danko Jones, man?
And I was like, finally, like, I told a promoter in France, I'm like, we can put Danko on the, you know, jukebox or whatever. I want to hear this. And I'm like sitting there, I'm like, oh my God, this is fantastic. And I remember specifically, it was 2004. I was in Montpellier, France. Whatever album that you guys had out at the time, we put it on. 2004, and unfortunately the promoter at the club gave us access to the bar, as meaning all four of us were bartenders, and we had a bar fight that night over that album. And that album meant so much to me. I don't know if you remember the joint in Montpellier and in France, but I mean, it was insane. And at that point I was sold. I was done. Yeah, it was like, I can't remember what it was, but it was just like, at that point I was like, oh no, at that point, that's, you know, going back to our single, I was like, no, I'm a Danko lifer at that point. And it's like, oh, I'm going to take a bar stool and beat this guy over the head because I love this music so much. And the guy just pissed me off because, well, whatever, you know.
Going back to what Danko said about, you know, the bands that, you know, kind of have a foot in each, you know, punk and rock. Those are like some of my favorite bands that I love listening to is like, you know, Nashville Pussy, the Super Suckers, the Wild Hearts. Like, very powerful fucking rock and roll, and there's punk about it, but it's kind of genre less in a way. Yeah. You know, what you want to call it, punk and roll a genre, but it's just good loud fucking music without the trappings from either one of those things. It just everything seems a little bit more pure, and Danko for sure is one of those bands where it seems to come from the right place, along with the bands I've mentioned before. And there's a million more of those bands too, but you know, those are some of the bigger names people know.
Speaking of this power trio right here, Ace Von Johnson figured out how to use the chat room and would like to be part of this little musical soiree when you guys eventually do it.
Well, tell Ace that the trio is three. So after the chat room,
Yeah.
Well, he moved he moved to Nashville, so he forgot how to count.
He'll have to sit on Pat's lap.
Oh boy. Whee!
Kidding. I love Nashville. Danko, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, you did mean to cut off.
Oh, No, Todd just mentioned Nashville Pussy, and it just reminded me we were talking about Chris earlier. One of the projects that Blaine and I are supposed to be doing as well is not a musical thing. We are reenacting scenes from The Odd Couple. So when we went on tour, this is like, because if anyone knows Blaine, or if anyone's even seen Blaine, you kind of know that Blaine would be
Jack Klugman.
Oscar. No. Yeah, he would be Oscar. Yeah. And if anyone knows me, I'd be Felix, real kind of like a tight ass. And so we actually joked about that and played off it. Blaine knows that I'm like that, and so does Ryder. Like, I'm very, a bit of a tight ass. So we've actually, I'm just so bad at it. I'm supposed to send him the scenes, and then we're supposed to cut our lines in front of an iPhone, and then I will edit it all together with the music and everything. But we were joking about that when we were touring together, that we should reboot The Odd Couple, me and Blaine.
Oh my God.
And all you degenerates listening or watching, he meant lines that they're reading. Just to get that straight.
Yes. No. A script. A script.
Yes. 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 And of course, you know, since I have it pulled up. Anyways.
Oh, I know.
I couldn't hear that one.
No, it's cocaine.
Probably a good thing.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
That one. All right. Yeah.
Make a cocaine joke. You got to play that. I'm sorry.
Yeah. I get it.
Part of producing on the fly, ladies and gentlemen.
Producing on the fly. Is he at work?
Is he at work? That's professional. Right. So, Danko, people want to find the record. Where can they find the record? Is there physical available, or is it just online?
Yeah, there's vinyl and CDs that I've held in my hand. I currently don't have a copy of my own. But they're available. We're on Sonic Onion in America, North America, Canada, and the States. And we are on Match in Europe. So go find it that way.
Was vinyl delayed for you guys up there?
There was a bit of a 3-day delay. People were saying they hadn't gotten their pre-orders, and we were told that there's a delay, like a 3-day delay, but everything's fine now. They should be getting it by now. It's been a week. So was there a delay in all the pressing plants?
Yeah, in the U.S.
No, we were talking about that earlier.
That's why. Okay, that's probably what we had going on too.
Yeah. Like our friend Priya Panda, she put out a single, and that even was delayed. A fucking single, it was delayed. You know, it's like
a single. Was that the cassette single?
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy. We're actually on a song together. That's coming out on vinyl. Nice. That's coming out on 7-inch.
Nice. And going back to Merch Girls, she's actually running merch for us tomorrow night at the Mint.
Oh, well, tell her that I have her book and 7-inch on hold for her, on reserve.
I shall. Absolutely shall.
She sang on it. We traded lines. Cover. It was a cover song of a local Toronto heavy metal band from 83 that never made an album, but they're pretty notorious in Toronto. So we did a song of theirs called Hateful Snake.
All right.
I'm going to do the plug here because I know Onion wasn't spelt right. So I want to make sure everyone who listens knows.
It's
Sonic Onion, UNYON. And they have, as of right now, they're going to be one less because I'll be ordering the Red Splatter vinyl the minute I get to fall. Awesome. They have black vinyl and Red Splatter vinyl. And yes, it's Sonic Onion, UNYON shop.com. So
yeah, people get it confused with Union or Sonic Union. We used to be on that label when we first started in 98, and then we had a falling out with them because we were just, we were both parties were just, you know, just kids, dumb, you know, really egotistical kids. And then we met up with them like 3 years ago again for you at a show, and we found out we really like each other and we're the only ones left standing. So we started working with each other again, and everything's fine. Everything's perfect. Like, we're all grown up. And
hey, it's funny how that works, man. The last one standing. That's another good standing.
If you're going to be covering, look, if you're going to be covering Canadian icons, when are we going to hear Doucette? Mama, let the boy play some rock and roll.
Ooh.
Jazz is much too crazy. Something, something, boho. Mama,
I don't know that.
Oh, dude. That song is fucking amazing.
What's the name of the band?
Doucette.
Oh, I only know DOA.
I only know Toxic Reasons. I don't.
I have a five.
Stretch Marks, SNFU.
And then there's what? Then what's there? The Kings switching to Glide.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah. I know that. Wow, you know your Canadian rock. Do you know Todd Kearns and Brent Fitz?
Oh, of course. Of course.
So they have a Canadian, they have two.
Yeah, the two
Canadian
Tuke,
cover band. Yeah.
I'm obsessed with K-Tel albums on vinyl, and I just got this one in Canada Gold.
Who's on it?
If this is one of the 300 you were selling, I bought it. I'm not. But a K-Tel compilation of all Canadian bands. So,
what are some of the bands?
It's Miles and Lenny, New Jigga Jigga, Edward Bear, Wednesday Shooter, Bond, Terry Jacks, Steppenwolf, Ann Murray, BTO, obviously BTO, Lighthouse, Rush, April Wine, Paul Anka.
Who's Rush?
Rush, haven't heard of those.
It seems like it just covers all the bases. Like,
That's what guys K-Tel. Doing. Like,
it's literally K-Tel. That's what those K-Tel albums are. But I was very proud of that one since we went Canadian.
Yeah,
that's a wow. That just pulled the air out of the room.
Well, before we wrap it up, Danko, I'm actually right now I am tweeting you the Doucette song. All right,
ooh.
Danko Jones. Right.
I don't know that.
Oh, I think once you hear it, you might.
Yeah, maybe if I heard it, I'd probably.
77.
It's 70. Those kind. Those. There's a few of those. A lot of those songs where I know the song, but I don't know the name of the band. Oh,
yeah.
No, I don't know. Okay. I got to hear the song.
All right, let's wrap this thing up. Before we go, the very important question. We can go around the room with this. So next week, the Kiss solo album Drunken Summit Throwdown. Any predictions on who is going to win?
Ace Frehley.
I'll second Ace.
Now keep in mind, we're going song versus song versus song versus song.
Yeah.
And the Ace record doesn't suck, so it's probably gonna win more often than not. Yeah. That's
I'll go Paul Stanley.
Paul Stanley's number two for me. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I'll go Paul Stanley number one before Ace for some weird reason. You know, who knows? But
it's always where the songs line up.
I'm
curious to see how I haven't looked at how the songs line up yet because I don't want to be either. I don't want to get that in my head because as soon as I see how they line up, I get all weird about listening to the songs differently. So it's just got to be, I can't do that.
So this is like Kiss fantasy football, right?
Pretty much. Well, here,
kind of, yeah. In regards to songs, in regard to,
the first one was the first three albums. It was the first three Kiss records. And it was Mike Portnoy, Charlie Benante, Roy Mayorga, Izzy, myself, and Eddie Trunk. And we had so much fun doing it. We just go song by song and we pick the winning song of the three. And then at the end, they get points and you pick the best album based on who won the most.
Hmm.
So it's kind of like fantasy football. And then we had so much fun with that group that we did the next three records. And then there were a couple jokes about doing the solo albums. And
and now it's here.
Give us a chance to beat a dead horse. So now we're doing the solo albums. That's it.
Perfect. Excellent.
Great. That's next week?
That's next Tuesday. Week.
Yep, next Tuesday.
Okay. Sounds next great. Tuesday.
So.
And then at some point, I'm sure there's going to be, at some point, we're going to go into the 80s. That's.
Yeah, then the, I think the lineup might change when we go.
Yeah, into the lineup's going to change because I'm. Just let
yeah, we Chris, might be, we
let
might
Chris actually, Jericho just talk for an hour about how great he is, and I'll go fold the laundry. I haven't finished folding yet. Yeah.
All right, let's close this bad thing up. I'm gonna hit the outro music really quick. Anybody have anything to plug as we're going off the air? I think we plugged everything. By the Danko
we
Jones.
We got to release out, but who cares? Danko's Power Trio. Yeah.
Well, you're released.
By Power Trio.
It's just so great to see Todd and Patrick again. You know, like, it's nice to see you guys, you know, amidst all this. It's important, actually, for me to see you guys. So
I agree.
It's great.
You too.
And say hi to all the other guys, David and Tim and Jimmy, please.
Yeah,
Bill. Absolutely. Good. All remembered all the names. That was fantastic. That was impressive.
Memorable bands.
Yeah, no, that's.
And that's, these guys as well. You know. Say hi to JC and Rich, definitely.
And Paul, it was nice to meet you.
Nice to meet all.
Yeah, nice to meet you. Yeah,
good
nice
to meet you, Paul.
Danko, yeah. Good hopefully to we finally meet you as well.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Thank everybody who showed up or watching.
Yeah.
I think this one will do well. Danko, appreciate it. Todd. Patrick, thank you guys. Mr. Paul Gargano, thank you. We will see you guys next week on the Kiss Drunken Summit. Don't forget, if you're in Los Angeles, come on down to the Mint tomorrow night for the Smoking Kills album release party. My name is Izzy Presley. This is Metal Age Magazine's another fucking podcast.